You might have heard of the Orange Bowl. Possibly you've heard of the Rose Bowl. I'm guessing you've heard of the Super Bowl. All of those pale in comparison to our upcoming competition, the Nerd Bowl. Soon, the sportiest of our lab are gonna go head to head with the most proficient ellipsoid tossers at Sandia National Laboratories, Facebook, and the Stanford Linear Accelerator. We call them the Slackers. Now, to minimize bruised knees, hurt feelings, and chronic traumatic encephalopathy, we're going to proceed with flag football rules for the Nerd Bowl, where tackling is replaced by removing flags from around your opponent's waistband.
I'm open!
In honor of this competition, today on Learning with Leland, we're gonna dig into the physics governing footballs as they soar through the air. To help me with this effort is Livermore's chief football trajectory initializer, Jason Loria. One of the wonderful things about physics is that seemingly complicated behavior can often be boiled down into a few simple governing principles. For our first data point, let's look at a soon-to-be game-winning toss by Livermore's quarterback, Jason.
All right, Jason, here's the situation. It's fourth down, bottom of the ninth, overtime. You've got one quiver left in your bow. Let that baby fly.
For our second data point, we're gonna have a less conventional trajectory, thrown by someone a little less athletic than Jason. Now, to protect the innocent, the identity of this person will be hidden.
Now, to help our anonymous thrower along, we're gonna give them some personal protective equipment. Ready for action.
Let's watch now our two trajectories side by side. At first glance, they look completely different. One is extremely complicated, wobbling and rotating as it gets to its destination. The other is a very smooth arc. An instant after the football has been released, there are several forces acting on it. There's air resistance, which in this case we'll say is small. And of course, there's the force of gravity pulling it down. The football is made up of billions of tiny atoms distributed across its ellipsoid shape. We might think that to calculate its trajectory, we need to take into account forces acting on each of these individual points. That might be a monstrous calculation requiring the world's largest supercomputers. Although we have those here on site, we don't use them to calculate football trajectories. Instead, a very simple property known as the center of mass helps us calculate exactly what's going to happen to the football very easily. The center of mass on a football is going to be right at the center of the ball. There's no material there, but that's really the average position of all of the material making up the football.
That was an awkward toss.
To know where that center of mass is going to go, we just look at the total force acting everywhere else and pretend it's only acting at that one point. Let's look at the two trajectories again, this time paying close attention to the center of mass. What we see is that the center of mass behaves exactly the same in the two cases. It's experiencing a uniform acceleration in the Earth's gravitational field, makes this upside-down U-shape that we call a parabola. From that point, we can consider their different rotations to be a separate piece of the motion. Once we decompose the motion into these two pieces, it actually becomes very straightforward. Step one, we pretend all the mass is located at the center of mass. We know how that behaves due to constant acceleration. Step two, we can add on the rotational motion based on its initial conditions. This idea of the center of mass simplifies the problem, and these two dynamics don't seem so complicated after all. Good luck at the Nerd Bowl, Lawrence Livermore National Lab. This has been Learning with Leland.
Oh, that was a good one.